Everybody, and welcome to the final panel of the day on the second to last day of the conference. Oh my god. Thank you, Elka, for having us. My name is Mita. I am the chair of today's session, this last session. We've got three speakers talking about marginalisation, representation of marginalised others. So first of all, we have Caitlin, and then we have Aaron or AJ, and then we have Mary. Caitlin's presentation is recorded, so we're going to play that first. But let me just introduce Caitlin, who is a PhD candidate in musicology at the University of Cincinnati. College Conservatory of Music, where she is dissertating on the 21st century television musical series and their portrayals of mental health, emotional crisis and identity via song. So Elka, I think this is your turn to take it away on Caitlin's behalf.
Trigger, content warning. I'll be talking about subjects relating to mental
health. Can you put the volume up a bit, Elka? Sorry.
Substance, drug usage, borderline personality disorder, and postpartum depression. The example I will play from Zoe's extraordinary playlist may also be upsetting to some viewers.
Sorry, that's as loud as it goes.
It depicts a character going through some extreme mental distress. The idea of using music and drama to explore heightened mental or emotional.
Sorry, I could try the other one. If that's louder. The online one. So this is the downloaded version. I could try the online one if that's louder.
Let's give it a quick whirl.
Okay, give a sec.
Gotta love a bit of technology, ain't you, really?
Substance, drug usage, borderline personality disorder, and postpartum depression. The example I will play from Zoe's extraordinary playlist may also be upsetting to some viewers. It depicts a character going through some extreme mental distress. The idea of using music and drama to explore heightened mental or emotional states, particularly in women, is hardly new. Mad scenes are found in many 18th and 19th century operas, including Doreste Deace from Mozart's Idomeneo, Il Dolce Suono from Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor, to the 20th century, including They're Always With Me from Corigliano's Ghosts of Versailles, and Steady, There You Are, Nearly Home from Britain's Peter Grimes. Although Sondheim's Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, could arguably be called one gigantic mad scene, epiphany is often cited as Sweeney Todd's. In the 21st century, stage musicals specifically about mental health cropped up, most notably Next to Normal, which premiered in 2008 and centered around depictions of bipolar disorder, grief, and depression. Perhaps it is no surprise, then, that the television musical series has picked up this legacy of depicting mental illness and anguish from its stage musical production relatives. Perhaps the television musical series is the ideal site to explore issues of mental health and illness because these depictions can reach a broader audience. Television, in its many forms, is one of the more accessible forms of entertainment, at least compared to ticket costs of opera and Broadway musical seats. No more bad pills, fads, or tricks. Who says there isn't an easy fix? With a diagnosis, I'm ready to float it. Joint, and by joint, I mean my inner sense of confusion. I'm aware mental illness is stigmatized. The stigma is worth it if I realize who I'm meant. naturopath used feathers to pet me. They said anxiety and insomnia were my affliction. The naturopath said it was sex addiction. But all those things I knew I wasn't. Yes, I like penises, but who doesn't? Perhaps one of the more well-known television series to depict mental illness is Rachel Bloom's Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. The main protagonist, Rebecca Bunch, becomes infatuated with a high school fling, Josh, and learns he's moving back home to West Covina, California. She decides to also upend her life as a successful New York lawyer and relocate to where Josh now lives. The first two seasons portray how Rebecca gets Josh back from his then current girlfriend, Valencia, and Rebecca and Josh getting engaged. However, season two ends with Josh jilting Rebecca at the altar. Season three begins with portraying the aftermath of Josh leaving her, and she spirals into a deep depression. Rebecca convinces herself that her friends hate her and flies back to her hometown of Scarsdale, New York. After a few days, however, Rebecca finds out that her mother has been spiking her milkshakes with antidepressants. Don't do this at home, kids. And so she decides to fly back to on the plane, she takes out a bottle of her mother's sleeping pills that she absconded with and proceeds to start swallowing them with a glass of wine. However, at the last minute, Rebecca hesitates and asks for help and fails at her suicide attempt. When she regains consciousness, she is at a hospital surrounded by the friends she thought hated her. Rebecca is also informed that she has a new diagnosis from a psychiatrist, which segues immediately into the song aptly titled A Diagnosis, which y'all just heard. On the surface, A Diagnosis appears to look and sound hopeful and enthusiastic. The song is in a major key, Rebecca is wearing a brightly colored yellow dress, and she is noticeably excited about finding what exactly is afflicting her. During the bridge section, Rebecca recounts her experiences with previous psychiatrists and therapists, who focused on trying to fix symptoms of anxiety and depression instead of realizing that they were comorbidities of a larger mental disorder. Even though she has had a frustrating past with the American healthcare system that has failed her, Rebecca seems really optimistic, singing the line "an easy fix" when she opens the golden letter that is supposed to contain her diagnosis. Depictions of mental health and disability in television series have slowly evolved from a topic never discussed to a central facet of a show's premise. Although in reference to physical disabilities, the phrase "superpowered supercrypt narrative," as coined by Sammy Schalk, broadly describes the quote representation of a character who has abilities or powers that operate in direct relationship with or contrast to their disability, end quote. Referring specifically to representations in television, Davy A. Johnson notes that, quote, "madness has become a means of managing individuals and directing them into productive circuits. Difference is not excluded, but cultivated as a useful social and economic resource," end quote. More recently, in a study of a sample of television dramas from 2010 to 2018, Rebecca C. Barron notes that characters are viewed as responsible if they choose not to take their medication, and if they do, quote, "it dampens their ability to perform valuable work in the community, thus removing their use value within the world of the series," end quote. Television musical series have the heightened ability to portray aspects of mental distress, such as depression and anxiety, through the added medium of song, as explored by Raymond and Zelda Knapp. In this paper, I pay particular attention to the series Crazy Ex-Girlfriend and Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist, which respectively use original and pre-composed songs to address topics such as diagnoses, postpartum depression, antidepressants, and emotional trauma. While Rebecca Bunch in Crazy Ex-Girlfriend copes with stress by mentally playing out musical numbers, Zoe Clark in Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist develops the ability to hear other people's mental states in her head through heart songs. Audiences may connect with these still stigmatized issues on a safer and more personal level in such shows for several reasons. One, the small screen of television is essentially a private, as opposed to public medium. Two, the vehicle of song allows characters to express their fears and emotions on a deeper level than occurs in dialogue. And three, agency is given to the creators behind these series, Rachel Bloom and Austin Winsberg, who have cited their own lived experiences of mental illness as the inspiration for and motivating factor behind their shows. Returning to Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, Rebecca is diagnosed with borderline personality disorder, or BPD. Now that she knows what she has, she remains in this mindset that it will be an easy fix, completing every workbook her therapist assigned her in a week and thinking she's somehow cured after a few therapy sessions. However, as people who have had to manage their mental illnesses, Rebecca realizes that while there is no cure for BPD, it can be managed via medication and therapy. Yes, she has finally gained clarity on what disorder she has via her diagnosis, but she also must learn how to cope with BPD for the rest of her life. Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist follows titular character Zoe Clark as she balances having a new job and providing for a father whose health is in decline. During Zoe's MRI, an earthquake occurs, which causes the medical technician's music playlist to somehow get downloaded into Zoe's brain. After this incident, Zoe realizes that she can hear other people singing, even in if real life they are not. Zoe comes to accept her superpower and dubs the music she hears as heart songs. She also then desires to try to help the person work through whatever they are thinking and feeling, but does so discreetly so as to not alarm them with her powers. One of the people she tries to help is Emily, who is Zoe's brother's wife. At the beginning of the episode, Emily texts Zoe multiple times, asking her to talk to her soon. During the day, Zoe realizes that people's heart songs are getting mixed up. In her head, the person singing the song is not the person feeling the feelings. Zoe thinks that something is wrong with her abilities, when in fact she had not been truly listening or hearing people's feelings. Zoe eventually realizes that Emily's heart song is Anyone by Demi Lovato.
I'm right here with you.
Anyone, please send me anyone. Lord, is there anyone? I need someone. Oh, anyone, please send me anyone. Lord, is there anyone? I need someone. 100 million stories and 100 million songs. I feel stupid when I think nobody's listening to me. Nobody's listening.
It's okay. I'm listening.
There is an initial layer to this song choice. Lovato wrote and recorded Anyone 4 days before they went into a drug overdose, something that they did not reveal until their Grammy performance the following year. Lovato describes Anyone as their, quote, cry for help, end quote, but no one, even themselves at the time, noticed or paid attention. They also noted that they did not put in a lot of time perfecting the vocal part on the recording, resulting in a recording with a certain rawness to the vocal timbre. And this backstory runs similar to what Emily appears to be going through. Even though she is singing Anyone, she claims that she is okay when Zoe is in the room with her. However, the following episodes shows Emily's downward spiral and Emily realizing that she is suffering from postpartum depression and that she needs professional help. One of the things that these series make clear is that the representations of mental illnesses depicted are not going to be exactly the same as the lived experiences of audience members who have the same types of conditions. Even so, YouTube comments on a diagnosis indicate that Rachel Bloom's depiction of BPD is highly relatable from both mental health practitioners to individuals with BPD. 4 years ago, Sarah El Sayed, who says she is a mental health professional, commented, quote, "It is really beautiful to watch the show address the reality of mental illness and that there is no easy fix." Cassie JWL wrote, quote, "The song nearly made me cry. So many people don't understand how often mental illnesses are misdiagnosed and therefore aren't treated. Depression and anxiety are often just a symptom, not the actual condition," end quote. Wendy Sharp added, quote, "This is exactly how it feels to be BBD. I don't know how they got it so perfectly without even trying or realizing it," end quote. In addition, other commenters noted how Crazy Ex-Girlfriend did not portray mental illnesses as melodramatic or skewed, but rather as honest and sincere. Similar comments appear below the Zoe clip I played for you. YouTube user It's Hout Outside wrote, quote, "If Emily's storyline is going to be her dealing with postpartum depression, then I'm here, all here for it. PPD happens to so many moms, and there's not enough shows or movies that tackle it," end quote. Cesar Perez says, quote, "PPD is a real thing, and women need to know it's okay to feel this way and to seek help. Too many times, mothers suffer in silence, and they need to know that they are not alone. I am a NICU nurse and have seen this too many times," end quote. As evidenced in these YouTube comments, the depictions of mental illnesses, specifically BPD and PPD, have resonated with the show's audiences. Additionally, these depictions are not shown simply as a one-episode arc. These mental illnesses are given time and space within the series. Because Rachel Bloom and Austin Winsberg are drawing from and sharing their own experiences and infusing those into their show's plot lines, audience members, or at least those who rewatch episode clips on YouTube, feel comfortable with sharing their experiences and diagnoses. In fact, they seem to want television to portray these once neglected issues with some sensitivity and nuance. Winsberg says, quote, "People will come up to me and say, I went through something like this with my dad, or my mother just passed away, or thank you for doing this musical moment here because it feels empowering. I wasn't expecting some of these reactions," end quote. Likewise, Bloom notes that, quote, "The thing that has aided me through my anxiety and depression is realizing I'm not alone. But in opening up to others, I found a lot of people have felt the same way," end quote. No longer do characters have to work through their emotions and mental state within the confines of a single scene or an aria. Instead, their mental health journey unfolds over several episodes or more, enabling the audience to understand that there is indeed no easy fix. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Caitlin. Thank you. We're going to do all the, I think we'll do all the questions right at the end after we've had all three papers, because there might be super themes or, you know, ideas that kind of come across all three papers. So we'll do all the Q&A at the end, if that's all right, Caitlin. Okay, so we're going to now move on to AJ, who, sorry, let me just bring up your bio. I did have it a second ago. AJ is an MA student at the University of Texas. She is also a writer, researcher, filmmaker, and activist. She received her bachelor's degree from Syracuse University. And I'm now going to hand over to AJ to take it away.
Thank you so much.
No problem.
I'm going to now share
just
my
to say, sorry, just to say, when you've got 2 minutes, I'll pop up. You know, in your time frame, I'll pop up to say that you've got 2 minutes. But yeah, sorry,
thank you. That is much appreciated. hi everyone. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah, okay. As our lovely chair said, my name is AJ Walker. I'm a media studies master's student at the Moody College of Communication at the University of Texas at Austin. If you were looking for preserving Black sitcoms, you're in the right place, because this is where Black Sitcoms Matter will be taking place. So just a little overview of my presentation here. We're gonna start off with an introduction, briefly going over the importance of the temporality of Black sitcoms. Then we're gonna do a quick activity with the show Girlfriends. And finally, we're gonna look at the implications of Black sitcoms. So Black sitcoms are forcibly erased, hence the title Black Sitcoms Matter. To start off with, they're most often never canceled because they had low ratings, even though that is the term that is used. They're usually forced to have low ratings because of things like the show was switched to a different network. Family Matters has happened to it. After 9 seasons, it was switched to a completely different network, day and time slot. Other things that happen are being switched to a different time of year that it's aired, with the 6th season of Hanging with Mr. Cooper. And
as AJ, I thought it might be my computer that's crashed. Has AJ?
No, I think it might be AJ that's crashed.
Right.
Shall we give her a second and see if she's coming back?
Yeah. I honestly thought it was me that had crashed.
Let me kick her out and then bring her back in. So. If I remove her, hopefully she would notice that she is... Oh, no, she won't, will she? Let me see. Oh, God, she will keep talking. Poor AJ.
How about, right, Elke, could you email her? And yes. Should we move on to Mary? Mary, are you okay to do your paper? And then we'll come back to AJ. Hopefully, if she's... able to rejoin us. So, introductions again. Our next speaker is Mary, Dr. Mary Irwin, who is a researcher within the Division of Media Communication and Performing Arts at Queen Margaret University in Edinburgh. She's currently working on a monograph entitled Love Wars, Television Romantic Comedy, which will be published by Bloomsbury. I'm now going to hand over to Mary to take it away.
And can you see my slides and hear me? Is that all good?
Yep, that's perfect.
Okay, so thank you very much, Meeta. I'm going to talk today about the BBC TV comedy This Country. Now, this research is drawn from a forthcoming Art Palgrave collection, which Meeta's just mentioned, UK and Irish TV Comedy, Representations of Region, Nation and Identity. And I'm editing that with my Queen Margaret colleague, Joe Marshall. And my interest in This Country came from its vivid portrayal of seldom seen on TV working class life in the rural southwest of England, and its representation of what Raymond William terms structure of feeling, capturing the specificity of living in a particular time and at a particular place. Oh, that's not moving. Hang on. Okay. An overview of This Country. This Country was made for BBC Three, and it was shown between 2016 and 2020. And it's written and performed by Saren Sesterborn, sister and brother, Daisy May Cooper, and Charlie Cooper. And it's set in an unnamed village in rural Gloucestershire, in actual fact, North Leach. And the comedy chronicles, in a mock documentary style, the aimless daily lives of disaffected, unemployed 20-something cousins, Lee Curtin Mucklow, played by Charlie, and Kerry Mucklow, played by Daisy May. And the title of this presentation, Turkey Dinosaurs and Double Dinners, This Country's Everyday Lives in Rural Gloucestershire, is drawn from the mundane preoccupations of its main characters, Kerry and Curtin Mucklow. And these include arguing over whose lunchtime snack gets in the hottest part of the oven, Curtin's pizza or Kerry's eventually victorious turkey dinosaurs, and a scam in which Kerry manages to have double dinners after she's let an elderly neighbour believe that her mum isn't feeding her properly. Now, This Country combines the deadpan candour of a direct-to-camera address, something people are familiar with going right back to The Office, broad knockabout comedy with dry, insightful, highly telling takes on contemporary young working class rural life. And this series makes frequent use of pointed factual on-screen captions used to highlight key political, economic and societal issues affecting such young people. Now, I'm not going to play the clip because it will take far too long in this very brief presentation, but all of it is up on the UK BBC iPlayer if people are interested after this presentation in looking at the series in more detail. The significance of this country. This country is markedly original in its situation of narratives of working class life in the rural southwest of England. And as I pointed out at the beginning of the presentation, this is a really little represented experience on TV screens. And the Coopers are depicting their own childhoods and adolescences there and reflecting on their home territory of Gloucestershire. Now, in historical British TV comedy, there are many very popular, well-known depictions of UK and Irish, most frequently urban working class life. And these range from the very well-known South London set Only Fools and Horses, Liverpool's Bread, Dublin's Mrs. Brown's Boys, Manchester's The Royal Family, Glasgow's Ramsay Nesbitt, and the South Wales Essex-based Gavin and Stacey. And the rural working classes of England's southwest are, however, absent in a UK which is consistently presented as split by simple and nuanced binaries, which most usually contrast southern wealth and prosperity with northern poverty and deprivation. Now, certainly other fictional recreations of the southwest of England, from Cornwall to the Cotswolds, are plentiful and resonate with a strong and vivid imaginary geography. This is a world of natural unspoiled beauty, conjuring wild seascapes, towering clifftops, romantic ruined castles, verdant countryside, frequently delivered in visually lush literary adaptations. And they're often shot through with a strong sense of melancholic nostalgia, articulating with a longing for a golden age of an imaginary, unspoiled past. And Paul Dark, pictured here, was a TV adaptation of Winston Graham's gripping historical novels of Cornwall dynastic life, set in the dramatic times of the American and the French Revolution, in both its 1970s incarnation and the very recent, much-watched 2010s versions. And in both cases, the mise-en-scene of beautiful Cornish coastlines, countryside, atmospheric wilderness proved tremendously attractive. And of the many available adaptations, pictured again, Thomas Hardy novels, both film and TV adaptations, offering lyrical recreations of country life set in Hardy's fictional recreation of Dorset, Wessex. And for Daphne du Maurier, Cornwall became almost a character in its own right, using its picturesque settings to augment the drama and supernatural atmosphere of her passionate, mysterious, fatalistic novels. And there are, of course, a handful of fictional screen depictions of superficially southwest working class rural life. Laurie Lee's much adapted Cider with Rosie, a poetic evocation of Lee's own family childhood and the Cotswolds, and Flora Thompson's Lark Rise to Candleford, semi-autobiographical trilogy about country life in rural Oxfordshire, which became a much loved Sunday night BBC drama staple running across 4 years. There's a quality of generic West Countryness about Lark Rise, which accords less with the specifics of its nominal location and more with the bucolic West Country landscape outlined above. But most important, poverty and suffering are simultaneously documented, but somehow made to look less difficult, less uncomfortable, set against a kind of rural, or perhaps more accurately, poverty chic. And this inflects the experience of rural poverty and being cold, tired and hungry, with a sense of it all being nevertheless part of something organic, almost mystical, enveloped in the eternal natural cycle of the ongoing seasons. Kerry and Curtin's experience of country life does not commote with the on-screen imagery and imaginary geographies associated with the southwest of England. The cycle and social geography of such locations reads rather differently to the local, long-established rural precariat, like Kerry and Curtin, those for whom the mythical Southwest represents desirable escapes from the country, dreams of starting new, simpler, more fulfilling, more sustainable lives. And noteworthy also is this country was made halfway into a decade of a UK Conservative government's imposition of a national austerity policy. And such policies had disproportionate impact on people like Kerry and Curtin, and of course the series creator, the Coopers, the poor, the young, and the financially insecure. So through its seemingly light and artless comic depiction of the Mucklows' bickering, bumbling daily existence, the series highlights difficult, divisive social and political themes. And Charlie Cooper, when interviewed on growing up in rural poverty, said, "If you're young and working class here, it's so difficult to escape. There just aren't any opportunities. You see so much about inner city poverty, inequality, but you don't see anything rurally, and it's so fucking difficult." And this country explores poverty, unemployment, lack of opportunity, isolation, mental health, and as mentioned earlier, the impact of the austerity-driven policies of the 2010s on the type of village in which the Coopers grew up. Now, this country doesn't preach, doesn't proselytize. It wears its cultural politics and observations very lightly indeed, showing rather than telling. It embraces complexity and frustration, and it doesn't offer stark, unnuanced polemic. Kerry and Curtin are at the mercy of brutal economic and social change. Yet despite their problems, they love their home and take pleasure in the mundane routines and events of their lives. They're often pictured messing about, having fun in and around nearby green spaces, fields and woods, relaxing, clearly at home in their own surroundings. They and their friends and neighbours are not depicted here as victims, nor the objects of pity of a well-intentioned but poorly informed visiting middle-class TV documentary maker. And at heart, the Coopers draw upon the experiences of their own rural upbringing and explore the mixed emotions with which they regard it. I'd like briefly to explore here something of a possible historical framework, and it's something that I'm still working through with regard to the text. To call this series a Condition of England text, in the sense of the eponymous Victorian novel, which grappled with the social issues and problems brought by the industrialisation of the day, is to overburden what is primarily a comedy text. Nevertheless, in the episodic overview of Kerry and Curtin's everyday existence, is visible many of the socioeconomic problems rural England faces, offering in its own way a Condition of England perspective on the implications for rural life of a shrinking and diminished agricultural economy. In order to make best sense of the very successful integration of comedy performance with knowingly implicit social comment, which the series mobilises, the rest of the presentation selects three key themes around which to organise the analysis offered. They are firstly, austerity. It's the backdrop against which everything in the series takes place, and it's frequently the driver of the action, or more likely non-action, which structures the narrative flow of the series. So the preoccupation of the Coopers, on whose life experiences this country draws. The church. It's highly unlikely that Kerry and Curtin have, or would ever have had, even contemplated attending a church service. Nevertheless, the church in the person of the vicar and the relationship with him and it is one of the most powerful stabilising forces and sources of moral and often practical support in their lives. Family and community. It binds Kerry and Curtin to their home village, and it's very important to them, whatever struggles that they face. Not having access to the money or means to change things is the backdrop to the Mucklows' lives. Throughout the series, the voice of the village vicar can be heard periodically explaining patiently and without complaint the threadbare resources the village and he contend with. A range of his comments include, "We did have a few sports clubs in the village, sadly the funding stopped and the clubs closed down." He continues, "I think there is a strain on local services in the village, a lack of funding. As a village, we had to rely on volunteers. And for young people in the village, sadly, There aren't a lot of job opportunities at the moment. Finally, and very tellingly, he points out, neither Karen nor Curtin have worked since leaving school. Other on-screen captions highlight rural 16 to 24-year-olds are four times as likely to be unemployed than the older workers. The future of many rural communities is at risk.
Because I have a presentation.
Oh, sorry, AJ, because you were thrown out, we started Mary's, and then we're going to get back to you if that's okay. So let's finish Mary, and then we go back to you. Okay, sorry for that.
Oh, no problem. Oh, sorry, my mic was not.
Oh, no, no problem.
I'm so sorry.
No apology. I'll just pick up. That's okay. So I'll whip through the second part of this. So yeah, rural 16, 24-year-olds, four times as likely to be unemployed than older workers. And the future of many rural communities is at risk. 200,000 young people leave the countryside every year to try and get training and jobs. And young job seekers in the countryside face uniquely rural barriers. And it's to force upon an episodic TV comedy, perhaps too much weight, to use it as some kind of measure in the consideration of histories of rural employment and unemployment. But nevertheless, as the series shows, without any overt or explicit commentary, within the climate of the cuts and closures of the period, lack of opportunity, lack of local work, have kept Kerry and Curtin living at home, dependent on family and domestic relationships. And this, as the vicar reflects, is a barrier to maturity and adulthood. And the second theme that's very important to the series is the church. And as the caption on screen points out, in Britain today, the number of people identifying as religious continues to fall, especially among the young. But despite this trend, the church still plays an important role in many villages through initiatives as diverse as food banks and support for carers. And it is the vicar who is Kerry and Curtin's only real support, and who is the one figure in their lives who's always there for them. And more broadly, the church and its immediate representative in the vicar, the Reverend Francis Seton Pictured, which are absolutely central to the well-being of the local community. And this country engages with real sensitivity and thoughtfulness with the values represented by and challenges faced by the Rural Church of England. And a New Statesman magazine interview with an Anglican priest, Alison Milbank, the parish system is a kind of spiritual NHS. The article stresses that Milbank's socialist heritage informs her support for the parish church, which she sees as a communitarian bulwark against the fragmentation of society. And Milbank says, we need things that can stand out against globalisation, against atomisation, that stand for the idea of the common good, the community, and churches at their best do that. And this is certainly what Francis Seton, the vicar, represents. And were it not for the vicar, Kerry and Curtin might spend all their time metaphorically messing about at the bus stop without any other distraction and getting into considerably more serious trouble. The Reverend Seton is a devastating, quiet admonishment of a big society approach when it's the little people, like a harried parish priest on a modest stipend, who selflessly take up the slack caused by closed libraries, unsupportive sports teams, and young people who lack focus and direction. And that the Coopers do not do any explicit politics within the series makes the implicit ones all the more powerful. And finally, family and community. In this country, despite all the struggles and hardships documented across three series, neither despair nor hopelessness are ever finally the dominant or lasting emotional note. Amidst the many challenges of Kerry and Curtin's lives, there are also some very happy and memorable moments. And this country is an imaginatively recreated world, peopled by engaging, infuriating, affecting, recognisable characters who embody and celebrate the everyday stuff of ordinary life. There's not time within this presentation to discuss in any detail the series' fantastic minor characters, from Kerry's horrible, unsupportive father, her unseen but highly vocal, mysteriously bedbound mother, Neighbourhood Terror Big Mandy, Borderline Vagrant Len, Variously Occupant of a Lockup or a Patch Under the Bypass to Gloucester, Self-Righteous Nagging Village Stalwart June, The Bane of the Vicar's Life, or Truculent Touchy Arthur Always Up for a Vite. At the same time, in events in the annual Steam Fair and the Village Duck Race, to Scarecrow Day and the yearly Harvest Festival, the Coopers depict with comic glee and real affection Kerry and Curtin's persisting relish for all the rituals and traditions of village life. This encompasses Curtin taking an aggressively competitive attitude to building the village's most impressive scarecrow, Kerry's forceful, over-enthusiastic approach to collecting donations for the harvest table, or more touchingly, all of Kerry's passion for the Steam Fair.
2 minutes left, Mary.
Okay, and so I'll just move from talking about the characters and the fact that the series is kind of a love letter to the Coopers' home West Country village and community. The Coopers, in the creation of their light dexterous, deceptively artless comedy, This Country, have exposed lives much like their own, unseen, uncelebrated. And they produced a series which interrogates and implicitly counteracts any whimsical romantic chocolate box cliches about England's southwest, whether in fiction or escapist travelogues, put to the customary face of its screen depictions. And despite the ubiquity of the New Cotswolds and the escapees to the country, lives of the inhabitants of the old Cotswolds, like the Mucklows and their community, can be seen if light is shone upon them. And in This Country, the Coopers present viewers with what is resolutely warts and all, their country. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mary.
Thank you.
Great. That was great paper. Thank you. So yeah, we'll do all the questions at the end. AJ, are you ready?
Yes. Can y'all see me and hear me?
We can see you, we can hear you. Okay. So do you want to start from the beginning?
Okay.
Yeah, let's just take it from the top because it was quite early on that we lost you. So yeah, if you want to take it away whenever you're ready. Oh no. Have we lost AJ again? AJ, are you there?
Hello.
No. I wonder if it's because the sharing.
It might be. Oh no.
AJ, if you can hear us, maybe stop sharing. And can email either Elka or myself the PowerPoint and we can have it up for you if you can hear us. Oh no, she's coming back.
Wow. I realize what it is. I don't think I can show my slides. I don't know what Teams is doing with me, but they're not letting me show my slides and show my presentation.
AJ, do you think might it be worthwhile sending me or Mita your slides as a link, and then
yes,
we can try and share on your behalf, and then maybe I get thrown out. That would be interesting.
It would. Okay.
So powerful are these slides.
Okay, copy link.
See, we're learning the technology as we go along.
And you see, I usually use Google Slides, so maybe this is the universe paying me back. But I tried to be fancy, so.
Yeah, I haven't received anything yet.
Really? Okay, I tried to send it back to the, did you send me the You Crashed email? Whoever sent me the You Crash email, I emailed them the link.
Okay, hold on. I'm just updating my thingy. Maybe it's arriving now.
There is still, on my teams anyway, there is still a potential that you're sharing.
No. The problem is that AJ is currently in twice, which she isn't, obviously.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to do is, now my email is not working. Give us a sec. Do you know what, AJ, basically what I would suggest is that you start talking, and as soon as I've got something, I'll share. Okay. Is that okay?
Okay, perfect. I can also drop it in the chat if that helps.
Yeah, try that.
Okay, take it away, AJ, and then we'll see if we can get this PowerPoint up and running, either myself or Elka.
Okay, no problem. Alrighty. So, as I said before, this is Black Sitcoms Matter. I think y'all got that part. Let's talk about why Black sitcoms are important, a brief temporality of what happens. So Black sitcoms are forcibly erased. What happens is, instead of being canceled, instead of their cancellation being because they had low ratings, they usually are canceled because they're forced off the air. Now this happens either because their shows are switched to a different network. This happened with Family Matters. It was switched to a different network after 9 seasons, or switched to a different day time slot, such as with Hanging with Mr. Cooper, which in its 6th season, instead of airing fall spring like it normally does, it was aired during the summer, which of course did not have its normal audience and of course then had low ratings. The next big problem that happens in terms of cancellations is that cast members are fired or it's a hostile working environment. The most famous in terms of the latter is with Good Times. The actor John Amos constantly was writing to the writer's room, constantly writing to the producers and arguing with them about how Black representation was shown and trying to get them to show Black people in a more positive light, to get his family on the show out of the ghetto. And unfortunately, they ended up making it such a bad work environment that he felt that he had to leave. And then in terms of cast members being fired, there's a show called Living Single, which Friends was, it ripped off the idea of Living Single from. Living Single, 1/3 of the cast was fired because they were continually advocating for themselves and trying to get Black content shown and Black issues shown. And that's why the show ended up failing after 5 seasons, because legit 1/3 of the cast was fired. A second reason for Black sitcoms having a short lifespan and being forcibly erased is, as you see here by the slide, series finales. As you all expect and know, when a show has 5+ seasons or it's a big show, it has a definitive series finale where the final episode wraps everything up that you have seen. Unfortunately, many Black sitcoms do not air their final episodes in the manner they were intended, with a different world. Instead of the final episode being aired in order, so let's say it was 10, 11, and 12 is how it's supposed to go, the 12th episode was aired in the space of episode 10, and then a couple weeks later, they aired 10 and 11. When it comes to other Black sitcoms, their series finale ends with a cliffhanger or... Okay, their series episode ends with a cliffhanger, or it's just a regular episode. The Wayans Brothers was the number one show on the WB. It was the reason that the WB even was established as a network. And its last episode was just a regular episode. You have never known that the series was ending. You can go to the next slide now. And this is very strange because there's many talented alumni that have come from Black sitcoms. In America, the highest award you can get as an actor on television is an Emmy, and the highest award you can get as an actor for film is an Oscar. So there are many Black actors who come from Black sitcoms and who end up winning awards from being on a Black sitcom, which is evident by this slide here. You can move to the next slide. Black shows may be made for Black people, but they appeal to all people. This may be something that is obviously clear, But unfortunately, when it comes to the entertainment industry, they continually tell Black actors, producers, and writers that only Black people watch Black shows, so there's no reason to make another Black show or create other Black content because the only people who watch them are Black people. You can move to the next slide. One more slide. Perfect. So the evidence of this is with The Cosby Show, which ran 8 seasons, 5 of the 8 seasons. It was the number one show in America for 5 consecutive seasons. This is something that to this day is a record only held by All in the Family. You can move to the next slide. Another evidence of the fact that more than Black people watch Black sitcoms, Insecure is written and created by and starring Issa Rae. Predominantly of the cast is Black, and the former president of the United States, Donald Trump, who views women as inferior and has continually used racial epithets, tweeted about Insecure. He was a big fan of the show. And that just shows you it crosses boundaries. Black sitcoms really connect to people on a deeper level beyond race, class, and gender. You can move to the next slide. So, Black shows were used as the groundwork to launch multiple networks such as Fox, WB, UPN, yet they are never given the credit for pulling in viewers and are usually tossed aside once the network amasses the viewers they need. This was said by Robert J. Thompson, who is a wonderful media studies professor. Next slide. So I'm going to be showing a short clip from the show Girlfriends. It was going to be 2 clips. But because that's going to have to be a scroll, I'm just going to show y'all 1 clip, explain what happens in the next clip. The show Girlfriends was created and, well, shown and started in 2000. It aired on UPN and the CW, created by Mara Brock-Akil. The Game, Being Mary Jane, are 2 shows that she also created. She's married to Sam Akil, if you ever saw that name. It starred Tracee Ellis Ross, who's in Black-ish, Golden Brooks, who you can see in the reality show Hollywood Divas, Persia White, Jill Marie Childs, and Reggie Hayes, who you can now currently see on Abbott Elementary. The episode that we're going to be seeing a clip from is from Friends, Colleagues, and Brothers from the first season of Girlfriends. The show chronicles 4 friends living in Los Angeles. Some people see it as the Black version of Sex in the City, but in LA. It follows Joan, who works as a junior partner at a major law firm. She is actually 1 of 2 women at her position and 1 of 2 Black people. She has grown frustrated and tired of her ideas being stolen. And so now she's trying to find a way for her voice to be heard. If you click on the, if you click on the picture, it should load to Netflix. Oh, wow. And apparently it only goes to, that may be too hard. Okay, I'll just explain what happens. That probably would be the best, unfortunately. Basically, what happens is Joan is in, they're in a room with all the junior partners. They have to fight to get a case. But to get the case, pretty much you have to argue a point. She starts to tell everyone in the room that she thinks that they should prove to get the case that there was basically that the other people were lying. No one hears what she says. And her good friend, William, who's the only other Black person in the room, the only other person of color, ends up saying her exact idea and getting the second chair, which is a very high position on the case. She, having been tired and fed up with everything, has an outburst and confronts him in front of everyone, says, "How dare you do this? I can't believe, especially this being from you." Then afterwards, they talk in her office. He feels that she should apologize because he feels embarrassed by his friend. She feels that he should apologize because she's like, "Dude, you should be on your team for your Black people." He feels that when he comes into the office that he's not a Black man, that he's just any man trying to get a chair from anyone. And she felt that he should have had her back regardless. The episode ends with her apologizing to William in front of the whole partner, all the partners and junior partners, and William looking out for her, making sure that when someone cuts her off, he says, "Joan is speaking," and he gives her the floor. You can move to the next slide. So what elements in the episode show Black life in America? What I can tell you is that Joan, in terms of how she dressed, she's wearing a pantsuit like everyone else in the room. But of course, her skin color is something that sticks out. The setting, it's a very small room. So where it's an intimate table, it gives you the feel of kind of like 12 Angry Men. Everyone wants a seat at the throne. The dialogue, they use certain language in terms of, especially with the argument between Joan and her friend William, they use certain language that are very indicative of the Black community. She calls him a house slave, well, a house N-word, which it goes back to slavery in terms of that person being the Uncle Tom, the suck up, the person who's treated better by the master. And William even says, we're not on the plantation anymore. So that goes back to the fact of these are things that are going, that are ingrained in society. These are things that are going back to historical in America, but there are things that they have to deal with today. And in terms of acting performance, Girlfriends in the first season does this thing that you see on Grown-ish, if you watched it, that it does character intakes. So we see Joan growing frustrated, Joan being livid, and her outburst, we know from the inner outtake of the character that this is something that is earned. But because she's a Black woman, it's seen as her being an angry Black woman, and her colleagues view it as her being on her period. And that's literally, that's something that is said in the show multiple times. You can move to the next slide. Have you ever felt like you had to choose race over your gender or one of your identities over another? This could be in terms of work, school, family, significant other, spouse, friends. In the episode, this is something that is very prominent. I know that as a Black woman, in academia, I have constantly had to think, ooh, how do I say this in a better way? Because I know that my status as a Black woman makes things come off as stronger, and my status as a woman makes me come off sometimes as inferior to other people. So I have to watch how I say things, what things I comment on. And this is true and can be true for other things. We can talk more about this in the Q&A. Or we can dive more into this in terms of the chat. You can put how you feel in the chat if you relate to things like that. Next slide, please. How does this relate to the entertainment industry and other work fields? I've given a couple examples here. We've seen this with Megan Thee Stallion and Tory Lanez's whole case about Megan Thee Stallion being shot and her versus him, and the public really villainizing her. And her constantly feeling like she has to stand up for herself and not feeling like people have her back. And she's constantly said, like, people don't believe me. I had to show pictures of my gunshot wounds. This also can be seen with Serena Williams and her catsuit debacle. She's had two catsuit debacles, actually, where she wore a full pantsuit and she was told she couldn't wear it because it showed her body too much and it wasn't real tennis wear. And that obviously was something because she's a Black woman, she's full figured, Black women's shapes are differently. She's come out and said things about that. And she's also had issues in terms of when she had her child about Black women's issues in terms of infant mortality rate, about people not listening to her. The blackballing of Janet Hubert, she used to be on Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. She was the original Aunt Viv. And once Will Smith said that she was hard to work with, she was unable to get a job after that, and people did not listen to her until Will Smith took his words back a year or two ago during the reunion special. There's also a Black women pay wage gap that shows that. There's multiple things that you can think of in terms of your own work field and other things in the entertainment industry of how this episode relates. Next slide, please. The implications. So I made a curriculum that looks at how to fill the gap of diversity within media while preserving the public's memory and access to Black sitcoms while offering children a history course that is fun and educational. Next slide, please. So this is an overview of the curriculum. I kind of gave you an overview with the girlfriends activity. It's actually a 4-week curriculum that is over 20 days. And each week is a different episode. So like we broke down the episode of Girlfriends, The first day would be over history. The next day would be about media studies. Like I said, setting, acting performance, mise-en-scene. The third day would be about how does it relate to you? And the final day would be about how can we see this in real life? How does this connect to today? It would end with a final research project that they can do a research project looking at an actor or a writer or a different show and researching different things that happen behind the camera and things that they were interested in and how that correlated to the lesson for the 4 weeks as a whole. Next slide, please. So what are the benefits of this? Why did I want to do this? It's because a curriculum that teaches students about Black sitcoms can expose students to watching the whole series. Maybe students will go, I want to watch Girlfriends after this. Oh, I want to watch Blackish because I've seen Tracee Ellis Ross and I thought she was funny in Girlfriends. Let me look for more things with her in it. Let me watch The Parkers now or more Black writers and Black directors then to seek more things with Black producers in it and more Black programs. And hopefully with this increased viewership, it will lead to a demand for more Black sitcoms being created. Next slide, please. Thank you all for being here and allowing me this time to present. I look forward to the Q&A.
Thank you so much, AJ. That was a really good presentation. There's my camera. Thank you all the speakers for your papers. So I will now open up the floor to our guests and see if there are any questions, comments before I take hold of my chair privileges and start reading off all of my notes. But no, please do either raise your hand, put them in the chat, come on the camera, come on the mic and ask away. Or if the panelists have questions for each other as well. We have a hand up from Gemma.
Hello. Really interesting papers. Thank you all so much. Mary, I was particularly interested in this country one, I think, just because I'm British in the UK context. That really resonated and I watched a bit of this country. I was just... this is me not taking notes properly, but the book that you were talking about that's coming out about kind of British and Irish sitcom, that sounds brilliant. I'm currently doing research into kind of Birmingham's representation on screen, especially in TV, but I would love to hear more about that. And when is it out?
Well, I'm really glad that you enjoyed the presentation. The book is kind of going through the final stages, so hopefully next year, and you would have been a great fit for the book. I don't want to take up too much time, but that's absolutely what we're interested in, the specificity of British regions. So thank you for those comments, Gemma.
Thank you. And I just kind of want a similar note. I want to say to AJ, this is, again, my ignorance as a white woman, but in terms of kind of when you say Black sitcom, I was thinking about a UK show called Man Like Mabeen, which is set in Birmingham. That's by an Asian writer called Guz Khan. Does that fall under your kind of definition of a Black sitcom? Because I, again, watching that has really resonated with me, and I think everyone should watch all different things. So yeah, thank you so much.
Yes, so I've never actually seen that show. Would love to watch it. I just love watching TV. But in terms of Black sitcoms, they actually do not have to be produced by a Black person. They don't have to be written by a Black person. In terms of Black sitcoms, they're usually designated by having a predominantly Black cast. So this is why, like, if you've seen the show, which it's rarely ever shown, Amos and Andy, which is one of the first, regarded as one of the first Black sitcoms, it was actually originally a radio show that was done in blackface, written by white people, but it's regarded as one of the first Black sitcoms. So it's just regarded as predominantly Black cast. If it has a Black writer, plus. If it has a Black director, super plus. And we really only see that era come in of Black writers and producers in the 90s and 2000s to, like, so 2000 to 2010. Hopefully we're seeing a resurgence come back of Black writers and producers for Black sitcoms.
Thank you. And then, yeah, my only other thing was, Caitlin, I loved your paper as well, and I'm definitely going to go and watch Crazy Ex-Girlfriend now. So thank you all again.
Thank you. Yay. Thank you, Gemma. Elke.
Hiya. First of all, can I just, I feel like I have to apologise as the organiser to AJ for the bad technology issues. I don't know what happened. But I actually have a question that kind of straddles Caitlin's and AJ's paper, which is about precisely about the being a woman and, you know, either suffering from mental health or being Black, and how that actually, particularly the gender aspect, is kind of policed from the outside, meaning we are policing ourselves, and how that is represented. I hate the word empowerment. I really do, because it's all post-feminist, isn't it? do you find that these programs, because they are so, because they center the female voice so much, present opportunities for empowerment in a way for women in terms of pushing those boundaries of self-policing in particular?
Did you want to go first, Gemma? I mean, not Gemma, sorry.
It's okay. Sure. Yeah, that's a great question. I would say yes, at least for
with the...
If I remember correctly, the last... Oh, am I here?
We keep losing your audio.
Oh no. Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Okay. If I remember correctly, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend ended in 2019, and I know a lot of stuff has happened since then, but I also feel like it's still very relevant. It's still very applicable. It can still empower women if we want to go that far. But at the same time, Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist, it was created by Austin Winsberg, a cis white male. But I feel like he's trying to, I don't know. I feel like that there's still a good representation of very women-centered issues in that show, and they're explored with nuance and sensitivity. Does that answer your question? Cool.
In terms of Black sitcoms, it actually directly relates, especially in terms of the 90s and the early 2000s of shows being created. Black sitcoms originally were family unit type of sitcoms that focus on the family. However, when A Different World got created in the late 1980s, it changed things because it focused on younger people. And one of the people that they focused on was a girl played by Jasmine Guy. And this was because Debbie Allen, who's the sister to Felicia Rashad, took over. And interesting fact, one of the writers on A Different World was Yvette Lee Browser, who went on to create Living Single. And she specifically created Living Single because she wanted Black people, Black women, to see how you live outside of college, because there was nothing to show Black people who were young adults on television. And then Mara Brock Akil, after seeing Living Single, was like, oh, that's amazing that there's, you know, young 20-something Black people on TV, but what about after you're 20-something? And that's how you get girlfriends. So it's literally this chain of women not only creating Black shows about Black women, but being inspired by other shows featuring Black women and basically saying, hey, I'm going to carry that mantle. Hey, I'm going to talk more about this. You literally wrote this character, and I'm going to expand more on that character that you talked about. There's a lawyer on A Different World. I'm going to make a lawyer on Living Single, and I'm going to have a lawyer actually practicing on Girlfriends. There's a direct relation of empowerment, of you can do this, of female sisterhood and lifting each other up on all of these shows. So it's a direct correlation. And even in Blackish, they had an episode where they brought all the ladies back from Girlfriends. So it's a full circle moment in terms of Black femininity and Black power.
Fantastic. It's great that you've got that kind of correlation, that you've highlighted that correlation. That's really interesting. Any other
questions? Can I ask yeah. Katie?
Yes.
So AJ, I don't know anything about this and it might not be your area of interest. Is international distribution of Black shows less good, less targeted than other shows? Are they not getting out? Because there's lots of shows you're mentioning I've read about, never seen them in Europe.
So it's interesting because I feel like with streaming, it has switched. So when it came to syndication, because you had to buy certain shows like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, it was syndicated around the world. Family Matters syndicated around the world. You know, there.
You're getting to the good bit. Oh,
I know.
You're getting to the good bit. Oh,
She's back.
Okay, perfect. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so in terms of 90s Black sitcoms, they were usually syndicated around the world. They got big, got really syndicated. But with streaming services, I have found that they are not as good, not only about putting Black sitcoms on streaming services. Like, until George Floyd happened in 2020, it was very hard to even find staple Black sitcoms on streaming services. You couldn't find A Different World. You couldn't find 227. Jeffersons was nowhere. Like, Living Single just got on Hulu in 2018. And Hulu is something that's been around for a long time. Mm. So I found it very strange because shows like Friends, shows like The Office, which are very big white shows, were easily on streaming services, were easily everywhere, even though that there were these big Black shows that were not only big in terms of Black community, but like I said, they're big in terms of nationally. They were the number one shows in America, the number one shows on that platform. Last point, I recently went to Mexico and I stayed there for a month. And when I was going through the different streaming services, even though, again, they had Friends, they had The Office, they didn't have the staple Black shows. Even Netflix, who acquired notoriously The Parkers, Moesha, and five other Black sitcoms to be like, hey, we have Black shows here. Like, this is supposed to be a part of their packaging plan. They did not have any of these shows in Mexico. I could not get Living Single on Hulu. They did not have Blackish on Disney Plus. They did not have Grownish on Disney Plus. You could not find any pretty much Black sitcoms, period, in streaming services in Mexico, and I'm sure in other parts of the world. And I think it's mostly because they think Black content is not going to be watched as much. And number two, I found that in Mexico, their idea of what's happening in America is very sheltered. They think that, you know, it's a perfect place. And Black sitcoms are very real. You know, they're funny, but they also talk about what's really happening in America, real issues that people go through. There's going to be an abortion episode. There's going to be an episode about police brutality. There's going to be an episode about whatever's the big thing going on, like A Different World, pretty much got canceled because it talked about the LA riots. There's going to be, you know, substantial real current event issues going on in Black sitcoms. And I always say, if you really want to know what's going on during a certain time, you should watch a Black sitcom, because it's going to have the top artists and it's going to have the top issue talked about. So I think it's also a sheltering factor that they don't want other people to know, oh, this is really what America's like, you know, good and bad.
That's such a great answer. And for me, as a sort of sitcom scholar, it's so frustrating. I read about great Black shows, I can't get them, particularly historical ones. So that's, I could talk to forever, AJ, but I'll stop. Thank you.
It kind of leads me on to think about the Black sitcoms here in the UK as well, and in particular one from kind of the late 80s called Desmond's, which was brilliant.
Mm.
Absolutely loved it. It was set in a barbershop, and it was like set in a London area. I think it was Peckham, so it was kind of a very Black area of London, and it was set in a barbershop, and it was really good. But I don't think that had a audience outside of the UK. Please do correct me if I'm wrong. And so I think it's...
No, it was not shown over here.
Yeah. Like,
Black people remember over here. And that's why a lot of Black sitcoms, if you watch them, they have former Black actors from other Black sitcoms in them, because we're like holding on to the memory, because there's not that many Black sitcoms, especially, like I said, before the 90s. You got nothing scraping things together. So if Desmond's was on, it would still be in syndication now.
We've got a question from Richard, and I'm going to read it out on his behalf. It's in the chat. Richard says, thank you all for such brilliant papers. I love all three focused on television comedy, which remains to some extent itself an outlier in television scholarship. To what extent does this make comedy a particularly fruitful televisual space for the representation of marginalized groups / outlying subjects? That's a great question.
I'll start really quickly if I can. Terrific sitcom this year, Derry Girls, looking at Northern Ireland, and when in the space of a sitcom, incredibly complicated, difficult material could be handled and was something that could be watched and thought about on a really big scale. So sitcom can handle, much like AJ is saying, it can handle really explosive, complex material, but the form is a delicacy. So yeah, sitcom comedy can do amazing things, and scholars, it sits on the margins.
I can second that. They definitely do not like studying comedy, because it's deemed as lower class, especially if you're like me or Caitlin. I'm studying Black sitcoms, and my other research focuses on children's programming, deemed lower, and Caitlin's studying musicals, which anything with a song is deemed lower, and with women, deemed lower. So it makes it hard, like really hard in terms of researching, because you need scholarship to make your research deemed important. Yeah. But the fun part is there's nobody who said what you said. So you're pretty much the first person out there saying your point. So it gives you a lot of room to say things. And I think that's the most fun part, is you're really out there, you know, laying the framework and the foundation, because especially what Caitlin's working on, like, there's so many more musical shows now, like musical episodes. Riverdale does one every season. Once Upon a Time, Cincinnati did a big musical episode. Like, it's a whole genre now. And of course, Disney Channel, which my master's thesis is on Disney Channel original movies, notoriously made them famous. So there's a whole like scholarship and information on them. And there's so much that you can work from and get from, that, you know, you can work around the fact that like there's no scholarship because there's so much text available. So that's what I would say.
I agree with AJ and Mary, what they said. I'd also add that I also made the point in my presentation that television itself is it's deemed as lower because it's just accessible to everyone, and I think especially with musicals, I don't know, I feel like a lot of people they sort of assume that, oh, it's a musical, it's going to have a happy ending, obviously, and I think now they can sort of, creators of these shows can subvert that and be like, yes, we are going to be talking about these sensitive issues. Yeah, they might be singing and dancing and talk and singing through it, but I actually think in some of these shows, especially Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, if they're singing about it, it's actually it might not actually be their actual feelings of, about things, because I don't know, I'm still, again, still doing my dis research, but it feels like if they're singing about these issues, yes, it'll be the gateway to them actually talking through these issues. That makes sense.
yeah, absolutely. You're very welcome, Richard. I just wanted to kind of think about, because Mary's, first of all, before I kind of go on with my question, please do, if anyone else has questions, put it in the chat or raise your hand. But I kind of wanted to think about about class or socioeconomic groups, and especially with the Black sitcoms, where I feel like, from my understanding, from my limited understanding, is that the characters in Black sitcoms are middle class professionals, you know, the lawyers, the doctors, I'm thinking of the Crosby Show here mostly, and how that's normally talked about in relation to something like Roseanne. But like the Desmonds that I talked about, that was very working class Black community that we were seeing being represented. And I think the British do have a lot of working class comedies that Mary talked about. Is there working class Black comedies?
The bulk of them are. So right, actually, When it started, like Amos and Addie, they were arguably poor. The joke was supposed to be they're poor, they're running around, and they're doing all these shenanigans. Then there's Beulah, which even though it had like half a Black cast, half a white cast, but it's about a maid. She was Black. Her name was Beulah. She's working class. Next, you have Sanford and Son. It's Red Fox, who owns a garage. Well, not a garage. It's a junkyard. He owns a junkyard with his son, Sanford and Son. You have Good Times, where they literally live in the projects, and it takes them 6 gruesome seasons to get out of the project. But they have all these talents and all these skills, and every single episode, they almost make it out of the project. It's like Gilligan's Island in the projects. I'm not even kidding. And then there's the Jeffersons, and the Jeffersons was the first time that a higher class Black person was shown. But you know, a lot of these shows are spinoffs. Good Times is a spinoff of Maude. The Jeffersons is a spinoff of All in the Family. So in All in the Family, George Jefferson owns a cleaner's. In the Jeffersons, the theme song literally says, "We're moving on up to the east side. We finally got a piece of the pie." He had owned 7 cleaners, and now he has enough money to live in a penthouse. But his kid didn't grow up rich. His kid is already grown, and him and his wife are empty nesters living rich. The first family to be like really educated and upper middle class, the Cosby started that whole thing. He changed the game in terms of Black sitcoms, because before they tried to reflect Black life, the Cosby Show, his whole thing was he wanted to make Black excellence. Like he wanted to show what Black people could achieve. So they went to historically Black colleges. Their kids were all smart. They were all the best. But like, if you notice, their kids never really like did anything because there's only a limit where you can go as Black people on television. Their kids couldn't be a doctor. They weren't gonna, like, television wasn't gonna allow that to happen, you know? And so then of course you get the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air probably is the richest that it gets with a judge. And of course Aunt Viv has a degree, but Will is from West Philly, like, and it's very much supposed to be he's poor living in this big rich house. And I mean, the Jamie Foxx Show, it's working class living in, he's working at his hotel that his aunt and uncle own. Like, even though there's people who have money, Sister was very much supposed to be working class / middle class. Moesha, working class, her dad was a car salesman. Like, a lot of the shows are very much supposed to be working class. The only people who were up there were like when it came to being educated. Living Single had a mix. Girlfriends, it was a mix of people. Right. So it really is trying to do the mix of showing different people. The real thing that the Cosby Show changed, and the shift that you can see, is the idea of what I call utopian representation. trying to make it seem like Black people have perfect attitudes, that, you know, we never do anything wrong, that there's no stereotypes. And I say it's utopian because, you know, we all have some stereotypes of the culture that we come from. I'm loud and I'm Black, but I'm also smart, you know? So we have things that are like our stereotypes. We have things that go against our stereotypes. And that's something that you see a lot of times online. People have a problem with when the representation is not utopian. That's why people have issues with the Proud Family, because it's not completely Black and white like they want it to be and perfect like they want it to be. So that's kind of like the difference that you see. And even now with Blackish, and I'll end with that, it's not a show that is like popular in the Black community, but it's a show where they have degrees and they're like the best, but it doesn't really connect to that experience of being Black working class or Black middle class, because of how much the show was written and trying to tailor to mainstream audiences and not trying to be like most Black sitcoms are trying to, you know, tailor to Black audiences and just so happen to garner other people. The Fresh Prince just so happened to become popular with other people, but it was definitely wholeheartedly made for Black audiences.
Thank you. Thank you for that. That was really thorough response. Elke, you've got a hand up.
Yeah, a follow-up question on that, because one of the things, when I teach television, I often look at American content, and for us, looking at American content is sometimes really strange because everything is so, ridiculously big and, like, you know, Shameless. When Shameless was remade in America, we were all like, why did he live in this big house? I suppose working class, right? So isn't the problem to some extent the American system, which is built around ideas of aspiration and, upwards mobility and stuff like that, that is completely not reflecting the American life, actually, rather than the problem being one of, you know, the way Black lives are now represented are not representative of Black lives, but actually the way American life is represented on American television is not American life. Sorry.
No, that's a fabulous question. I actually have this joke with my dad, and I'm always like, why can white people always live in big houses? Like, you watch like any movie or show with white people and they're poor and they somehow like have this extravagant house, like Terms of Endearment, if you've ever seen that. How is she a single mother and she lives in that house and she's a waitress next to an astronaut? Like, it makes no sense. But white people don't have to explain that. If it was a Black person or a Latino person or an Asian person, like, they would have to have some explanation in the series of how they got to that neighborhood and that big house, or there'd have to be 15 people living in there and we'd get that they all chipped in to live in that big house. So I think when it comes to especially white people on television and in terms of American television, that like the sky's the limit. Anything is possible. Nothing has to be explained. Friends, how did they afford living in Manhattan? Like, nothing has to be explained. But when it comes to Black people and other people of color, nothing has to be explained in terms of being poor. Like, they're like, oh, you just know they don't have money. Like, the explanation comes when they have money. The explanation comes when they have education. So I think in terms of white Americans, they get to live the American dream. Our content usually has to be us working towards it. Ugly Betty, what are they doing? Constantly working towards the dream. New Girl, she gets to start at the dream. Like, everyone gets to start at the dream pretty much in terms of white television versus people of color. We have to, fresh off the boat, work towards the dream. And usually the end of the series is, we finally made it to the dream after 5 seasons 9 seasons of working towards that part. And it's unfortunate. And I guess in total, you know, there's this smoke and mirrors. But I think that in terms of white people, they get the imagination. I forget who says it, but like white people get to have, when it's a sci-fi, it's a fantasy. You got to be put in a different world for like crime to happen, for something terrible. But like, think about Get Out, it's just racism. Like, that's kind of how it is in America, that white people get all these open boundaries and people of color get put in a box because of our limitations just in life. And it's reflective, but like at the same time, it's not reflective because you see so many people outdo themselves and their circumstances.
If you want to see some palatial houses that are so out there, watch Indian serials, because my God, they are palace. Like, a normal family live genuinely in a like a old Rajput like palace, like for a king. And my participants were like, have you ever seen houses like that in India? I've never seen them. They're not like the houses we live in. Like, genuinely, one of them was even asking me, like, where do they sleep? You know, they're like the huge palaces. Anyway, sorry. That was just my little thing. Mary, please do.
Just a final point to kind of continue the conversation with AJ. I think that in Brit sitcom, unlike in the US, aspiration isn't necessarily always the focus. So Brit sitcom can celebrate failure, melancholy, the mundane and the everyday, which I think gives British sitcom sometimes a different flavor. So because we don't have the great American dream, sadly, and that's one of our problems, but British sitcom can kind of celebrate mundanity, failure, not being a winner. And I think that makes a really interesting dialogue, stereotypes about national cultures, but aspiration plays differently in UK culture, I would say.
No, it that's why The Office gives it more room, you know, because comedy does come from tragedy, you know. And I think you're absolutely right, like you said, comparing British Office versus American Office. Oh. If you compared Living Single versus Friends, Living Single has real text, real teeth. Friends is just something that you watch when you fall asleep. Like, there's no background, no information. No, that's not Living Single.
It's a great, the two offices are a brilliant comparison. I think the skill to adapt this really downbeat, nuanced, knowing little British series and make the US Office, that's brilliant work to reimagine those textures. We could talk about that forever as well. That's such an interesting comparison.
I think we've hit the if there's no more questions or comments, thank you all for a great discussion. Thank you, Mary, thank you AJ, thank you Caitlin for all your papers.